الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له هاديا مرشدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فاللهم اجزه عنا أفضل الجزاء يقول الله تعالى في آل عمران يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون ويقول في مطلع سورة النساء يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا ويقول تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما It's all about taqwa, brothers and sisters. It's all about piety and remembering Allah in every moment of our lives. أما بعد فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله Remembering Allah Be aware of Allah ومراقبته في السر والعلن فإنه سبحانه رأس الأمر كله The best words are those of Allah The best guidance is that conveyed by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The worst of issues are innovations in this deen, for these open the doors to misguidance and the doors to hellfire. I remind myself and all of you, brothers and sisters, to be aware of Allah in all our states. One of the most commonly known and popular ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar, Buniya al-Islamu ala khams. Shahadati an la ilaha illa Allah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Wa iqam as-salah wa ita'i az-zakah wa sawm Ramadan wa hajj al-bayt man istata'a ilayhi sabila. The hadith, as you all know, talks about the five pillars of Islam. So Islam is a huge palace or castle with many regulations or shara'a, ruling the relationship with our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, with our parents, with our relatives, with our friends, neighbors, rulings of inheritance, rulings in circumstances of life and death, and so on and so forth. If any of these pillars collapses, the whole structure would collapse. Those pillars are the article of belief. Salah, five times a day. Zakah, charity, which is a continuous process in our life. Siyam, at least 1 month of the year, which is the month of Ramadan. The puzzling part, brothers and sisters, is Hajj being one of the pillars of Islam. Once in a lifetime. So it is the only pillar that is required once in a lifetime, and only in case of having the capability to perform it. Millions of Muslims did not perform Hajj, and millions would die without having the capability of performing Hajj. Even those who perform Hajj, it's once in a lifetime. How would 2 weeks or less of your life be considered a pillar of Islam? How could a transient trip for such a short time become a pillar of Islam? How about those who didn't and wouldn't be able to perform Hajj? Are they out of Islam? The benefit of the season of Hajj, brothers and sisters, has to be for the whole Ummah. Those in Hajj, those who are not in Hajj, and those who did not and will not perform Hajj in their lifetime. So what is the wisdom behind Hajj being one of the pillars of Islam? Ever since Ibrahim and Ismail alayhim as-salam raised the bases of the first house of worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave instructions to Ibrahim alayhi salam. وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ يأتين من كل فج عميق ليشهدوا منافع لهم and publicly proclaim pilgrimage, make azan for all mankind, so that they come to you on foot and mounted on lean camels, atrophied from the long travel, from every distant deep point and direction, to witness the benefits in store for them. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ To witness the benefits in store for them. The word manafi', brothers and sisters, is a vast, general, and encompassing word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very wise in the use of His own words, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most important benefit of Hajj is reminding the Ummah of the Day of Judgment. Most of the problems of humanity, committing sins, misguidance in the land, are results of forgetting or ignoring the fact of the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Sad, إن الذين يضلون عن سبيل الله لهم عذاب شديد.
Why?
لهم عذاب شديد بما نسوا يوم الحساب.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Allah's severe chastisement, torment awaits those who stray away from Allah's path. Why? For they had forgotten the day of judgment, the day of resurrection. Forgetting the day of reckoning is a disaster, brothers and sisters. From the very beginning of da'wah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was reminding people and teaching them, وَاللَّهِ لَتَمُوتُنَّ كَمَا تَنَامُونَ وَلَتُبْعَثُنَّ كَمَا تَسْتَيْقِظُونَ وَلَتُحَاسَبُنَّ عَلَى مَا تَعْمَلُونَ وَإِنَّهَا لَجَنَّةٍ أَبَدًا أَوْ نَارٍ أَبَدًا. I swear by Allah that you will die like you sleep. You will be resurrected like you wake up. And you will be held accountable for what you do. Then it is eternal heaven and gardens or eternal hellfire. Very simple message to humanity. Brothers and sisters, if we were to remember the last day, the conditions of humanity would have changed. We would have reconsidered our standing in many, many of our life situations. We would have reconsidered the whole issue of our lifetime. It would have been a grave shock that would awaken the whole ummah. Imagine a world where people are aware of the day of resurrection, the day of reckoning, all the time. Who would then steal? Who would be unfair? Who would lie? Who would mistreat his or her parents? Who would mistreat his brothers and sisters? Who would mistreat his or her neighbors? And so on and so forth. Who would commit any form of sin? Rectifying and treating the ailments of humanity, brothers and sisters, the ailments of humanity and the ailments of life on our planet is simply in remembrance of the day of reckoning. Hajj is a vivid, outspoken, and clear reminder of the day of reckoning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. And have fear of the day when you shall return to Allah, and every human being shall be fully repaid for whatever good or evil he has done, and none shall be wronged. All the steps of Hajj, brothers and sisters, aim in that direction. Look at the person preparing for Hajj, preparing to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saving money for the journey, no matter how hard it is to save, making sure that the source of money is only halal, happy and pleased to spend thousands of dollars for the trip to go back to Allah, to emigrate to Allah, even for such a few days of Hajj. Look at the words all the Hajjaj are saying upon Ihram. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk. لا شريك لك. Oh Allah, responding to Allah's call. Oh Allah, here I am, coming to respond to your call. Oh Allah, you have no partners. Here I am, oh Allah. Indeed, all thanks are due to you. All blessings are from you. All kingdom is yours. No partners with you, oh Allah. Look at the one getting ready for the journey, checking on his relations with people, making sure he owes nobody anything, making sure he clears any discordance with anyone before he goes, as if he's going to the last day. Look at him leaving his wasiyah or will before he leaves. Look at him giving his farewell goodbye to his family and friends as if it could be his last journey. The difference is, on the journey of death, there is no coming back. Look at the clothing of the Hajjaj, as simple as it gets, and as equal amongst all as it gets. So the whole atmosphere of Hajj preparation is a reminder to the person going for Hajj and his surrounding family, friends, and even the whole community of death and the hereafter. Throwing the world behind his back or her back and going for worship, for obedience, asking forgiveness, dua, supplication, and submission, and humbling oneself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the land of Hajj itself, I mean Mecca and the surroundings, there is extreme crowdedness. And this is how people are going to be resurrected on the day of reckoning. In one place at the same time, when they are called, come unto your Lord, come unto your Lord, halummu ila rabbikum, halummu ila rabbikum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beautiful ayah in Surah Taha. يومئذ يتبعون الداعي لا عوج له وخشعت الأصوات للرحمن وخشعت الأصوات للرحمن فلا تسمع إلا همسا. On that day, people shall follow straight unto the call of the summoner, no one daring to show any haughtiness. Their voices shall be hushed before the most compassionate Lord, so that you will hear nothing but a whispering murmur. Brothers and sisters, everybody is standing on the day of reckoning. وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْؤُولُونَ. And detain them standing there. They will be called to account. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يعرق الناس يوم القيامة حتى يذهب عرقهم في الأرض 70 ذراعا ويلجمهم حتى يبلغ آذانهم. أبو هريرة, may Allah be pleased with him, quoted the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as saying, people will be sweating on the day of judgment till the land absorbs their sweat 70 arms deep, and the sweat will rise up to their ears. May Allah make it easy, inshallah. Hajj is the only form of worship to which a Muslim leaves for multiple days, brothers and sisters, for which a Muslim devotes a long time. So is the day of judgment. It will be a long day. Inna nakhafu min rabbina yawman abusan qamtarira. We fear from our Lord a day that shall be long and distressful. Qamtarira is a very long day. Abdullah ibn Umar said the day will be equivalent to 100 years. And Ka'b said it's going to be equivalent to 300 years. Look at the sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Reminds us of the motion on the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ يَخْرُجُونَ مِنَ الْأَجْدَاثِ سِرَاعًا سِرَاعًا كَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَى نُصُبٍ يُوفِضُونَ. In Surah Al-Ma'arij, the day on which they will hastily come forth from their graves as though they were hurrying on to the altars. People would run to Adam alayhi salam, who refers them to Nuh alayhi salam. They go running to Nuh, who refers them to Ibrahim alayhi salam, who refers them to Musa alayhi salam, who refers them to Jesus alayhi salam, who refers them to Muhammad, peace be upon him, going back and forth between the messengers of Allah. Only in the hope they would ask Allah to start al-hisab. Asking Allah to start al-hisab on that very long day and put an end to their long wait in the crowd, in the sweat, the hot weather, and the sun getting close to their heads. Illa man rahima rabbi. Visiting the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brothers and sisters, though not part of this, of the rites of Hajj, is another reminder of how we'll meet with our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions, how we will greet them, how we will ask his intercession on that rough day. Add to this, during the visit of Medina, praying in Rawda, which is considered part of Jannah, a whole atmosphere surrounding Hajj that gets you out of this world and makes you live a rehearsal of the hereafter. Thus the whole Muslim Ummah lives a rehearsal of the day of resurrection, the day of judgment, the hereafter, once every year during the season of Hajj. No wonder Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts Surah Al-Hajj exclusively talking about the day of judgment. Look at this. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم. سورة الحج starts reminding us about the day of judgment. إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. O mankind, fear the wrath of your Lord. Indeed, the earthquake of the hour of judgment will be a grave thing. On the day when you witness it, the suckling woman shall utterly neglect the infant she suckles, and every pregnant woman shall cast her burden, and you will see people as though they are drunk, and they are not drunk. But dreadful shall be Allah's chastisement and torment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't order us to go for Hajj to torment us. مَا يَفَعْلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. Why should Allah deal chastisement to you, torment to you, if you are grateful to Him and believe? If we remember the day of judgment, brothers and sisters, everything in our lives, but even all over our planet, will improve to the better. Even our hereafter will improve to the better. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه وأنتم واثقون بالإجابة. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ومن والاه. Brothers and sisters, Hajj is a pillar of Islam that has innumerable benefits to those at Hajj as well as those who are back home. So if we are not at Hajj this year, what's the significance of this season to us here at home? Brothers and sisters, we are blessed to be living those beautiful days of the first 10 of Zulhijjah. Alhamdulillah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by these days in Surah Al-Fajr. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, wal fajr wa layalin 'ashr, wash shaf'i wal watr. By the dawn
the 10 nights which we are living now, and the even and the odd, the 9th and 10th of Dhul-Hijjah. The Prophet, peace be upon him, also teaches us the significance of these beautiful days in hadith. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن أحب إلى الله منه في هذه الأيام العشر. قالوا ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله؟ قال ولا الجهاد في سبيل الله إلا رجل خرج بنفسه وماله ولم يرجع منه بشيء. أخرجه البخاري. There are no days in which a good deed is more beloved to Allah than these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. They said, not even struggling in the way of Allah, O Prophet of Allah. He said, not even that. Except for a man who went out in the way of Allah with all his wealth and his soul, and he didn't come back with any of that. So there are good chances for good deeds, most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during these beautiful days. I worked on collecting some of these good deeds that we can work on for these days remaining of the first 10 of Dhul-Hijjah, brothers and sisters, and I'd love to share them with you. Number one is fasting. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fast the first 9 days of Dhul-Hijjah, according to the narrations of most of his wives. The least we could do is fast the day of Arafah, which happens to be on Monday, inshallah, this year. This would give you forgiveness of the sins of the last year and this year, inshallah, according to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Number two, praying in congregation as much as we can for men, and praying on time at the beginning of time of salah for women. These are good habits to develop during these beautiful days and extend them to the rest of the year, inshallah. Three is fulfilling supererogatory prayers, nawafil, as much as possible during these days, and extending this to the rest of the year. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said that whoever prays 12 rak'ahs of nawafil a day, Allah would build him or her a palace in Jannah. These include Sunan al-Rawatib, most commonly performed Sunan by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salatul Duha, Qiyamul Layl. The fourth good deed that I remind myself and you of is Zikrullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah says, وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ. And in Surah Al-Hajj, وَيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ. And to pronounce the name of Allah during the appointed days. Those days are agreed to be the first 10 of Dhul-Hijjah. Abu Hurairah and Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma were known to do tahleel and takbir and tahmeed in the marketplace during those days, and people would repeat after them. وَذَّاكِرُونَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us to mention him repetitively and a lot. Number five is dua, supplication. The significance of dua cannot be overstated, brothers and sisters, especially during those days, especially in the last third of the night, and especially in a state of sujood. Hadith, أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه وهو ساجد فأكثر الدعاء. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم teaches us that we are closest to Allah when we are in a state of prostration. Number seven, creating an atmosphere of camaraderie and brotherhood between members of the Muslim community. Being good to our parents, birrul walidain. Spreading peace with friends, neighbors, brothers and sisters, relatives, salatul rahim. Number eight is giving charity. One of the beloved deeds to Allah during those days is spreading happiness to the unfortunate of this ummah. وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَلِأَنفُسِكُمْ وَمَا تُنْفِقُونَ إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ. Number nine, behaving like hajij, especially if you are to slaughter a sacrifice on the 10th day or يوم النحر. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا دَخَلَتْ الْعَشْرِ وَأَرَادَ أَحَدَكُمْ أَن يُضَحِّي فَلَا يَأْخُذَنَّ شَعْرًا وَلَا يُقَلِّمَنَّ ظِفْرًا.
whoever wants to sacrifice this year, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recommends no shaving, no cutting hair, and no trimming nails. And the last to remind you of during these days is the sacrifice in the way of Allah, al-dhabiha. Aisha radiallahu anha narrates after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ما عمل ابن آدم يوم النحر عملا أحب إلى الله من إراقة دم. That the most beloved deed to Allah on the day of Nahr is the act of slaughtering and sacrificing for the way of Allah. Allahumma innaka qulta wa qawluka al-haq. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Inni da'in fa'amminu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin fil awaleen. Wa salli ala Muhammadin fil akhirin. وصل على محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم أجرنا من النار وأسكننا الجنة. اللهم ألف بين قلوب المسلمين المؤمنين. اللهم اجعلنا رحماء فيما بيننا يا رب العالمين. O Allah, harmonize our hearts and make us merciful to each other. اللهم لا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا. O Allah, please do not give us trials in our deen and creed. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر المستضعفين من المسلمين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها يا رب العالمين اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم أمواتنا وأموات المسلمين اللهم احفظ أبناءنا وبناتنا واجعلهم من عبادك المتقين واجعلهم من حملة كتابك الحنيف برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم ردنا إلى دينك ردا جميلا من غير محنة ولا عذاب O Allah, please return us to your straight path without hardship or torment. Allahumma a'inna ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. O Allah, help us to remember you, be thankful to you, and to be some of your good servants. Allahumma aj'al khayra a'malina khawatimaha wa khayra ayyamina yawma an nalqaka wa anta radin anna ya rabbal alameen. اللهم اسقنا من يد حبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا اللهم احشرنا تحت لوائه واجمعنا معه في الفردوس الأعلى اللهم يسر لحجيجنا أداء مناسكهم وأعدهم إلينا سالمين لديك مقبولين يا رب العالمين اللهم يسر لنا حج بيتك وزيارة قبر نبيك صلى الله عليه وسلم اللهم اجزه عنا أفضل الجزاء ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم I have a few announcements, brothers and sisters, just reminders. That alhamdulillah we have a second Jum'ah that starts at 2:45.